Hello and welcome back to Sam's Disney Diary, episode number 96, D23 Expo 2017. Marc Davis goes to WED, the amazing artistry and designs of the legendary Disney Imagineer. One of Walt's nine old men, Marc Davis is an artist. He joined Disney in 1935 as an apprentice animator on Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. His first animation credit? The Snow White dancing sequence. Not a bad start. He moved to sketching and character design for Bambi, where he leveraged his animal background to add lifelike movements to the animals. After Bambi, Marc stayed with Walt Disney through World War II, working on films like Victory Through Air Power. After the war, Marc moved on to Song of the South and later became the lead animator behind many of your favorite Disney characters, mostly leading ladies, from Cinderella to Aurora and Maleficent in Sleeping Beauty, Thumper and Flower in Bambi, Tinkerbell in Snow White, Alice from Alice in Wonderland, and his favorite, Cruella de Vil in 101 Dalmatians. Now, after Dalmatians in 1961, Marc was recruited by Walt to become one of the original members of WED Enterprises. An original Imagineer, Marc was heavily involved in the development of all of the 64-65 World's Fair attractions, from the dinosaurs in Fords Magic Skyway to the family in Carousel of Progress or Children of the World, or creating the illusion that Abraham Lincoln could stand up. After the World's Fair, Marc followed the attractions back to Disneyland, where he noted that none of the existing attractions included humor. He worked on the redo of the Jungle Cruise that included the introduction of the now famous humor. Can you imagine Jungle Cruise without the humor? Marc went on to heavily influence Tiki Room, The Country Bears, Haunted Mansion, Pirates of the Caribbean, and became the go-to Imagineer of the late 60s and 1970s. Marc retired in 1978 and received the Disney Legend Award in 1989. While Marc's animation career is well documented, a renewed interest in Marc's time in the early days of WED, along with the discovery of some new, never-before-seen artwork, photography, and work on attractions that never happened, like Yestermorrow Time Machine, the Fort Wilderness Funhouse, the Garden of Gods, or Silly Symphonies attraction, resulted in a D23 Expo 2017 panel discussion hosted by Peter Docter of Pixar and Christopher Merritt, a Disney Imagineer, highlights Marc's time in Imagineering, the focus of a forthcoming book by Peter and Christopher. That book's on my list and I can't wait. And I hope you enjoyed this full panel discussion from the D23 Expo 2017, Marc Davis Goes to WED. Thanks for watching and Kongaloosh!
Students, you know.
Right, right.
It really felt patents imported. I love that. I mean, later as I would go to Mark's and Alice's house, I don't think I've ever been in there without Alice feeding me food.
Right. And I had my very first martini made by Mark
Davis. Oh, yeah.
Knocked me for a loop. So we love them. We think they're great. They're amazing. There hasn't really been a book yet that's been done on Mark's Imagineering years. So we want to do something that's big and beautiful and amazing. And I used to go, when I visited him, I tape recorded him a lot because he would say, you know, I'd say, well, tell me about what's on the Haunted Mansion, or tell me about what's on the Jungle Cruise. And he'd tell these amazing stories about, you gotta get this on tape. And it turns out a lot of other people recorded them as well. So we've got this wealth of material in Mark's own words to pull from.
And that's one of the cool things about this book is that it will be basically Mark describing his artwork, his process, the historic nature of what he's doing. So it's pretty amazing.
Right. So when we finally decided we wanted to do this, of course, the first thing we did was we called up Alice Davis and we went over to her house and spent the day with her and showed her kind of what we wanted to do. And she said, oh, wonderful, I would be so pleased. And which was great. And we said, well, we're very interested in any materials you have around the house that you and Mark might have kept from your career. And she took us back to Mark's office. And so both you and I were lucky enough to visit Mark in his office when he was still with us. But Alice has pretty much kept his office the same as how it used to be. And we found the most amazing things back there in closets and drawers.
Under other artwork, you know, just layers of amazing stuff.
And it's just killing, you know, you open an old, you know, drawer and you find all these photos and you see Mark's, you know, ordered to loop the camera, and, you know, to order the prints. So what's really cool about this is there's a personal aspect to this as well. So you're going to get the company aspect, but you're also going to kind of go through it with Mark and Alice as he had his basically second career. You know, there's even funny things like, here's a Mark Davis selfie.
I'm not sure if that's intentional.
Yeah, we're not sure.
The camera just went off.
But one of the most shocking things that we found, this is incredible, we were rooting around in there, and under Mark's desk, back in the back corner, there was an old cardboard jelly jar box, and we pulled it out and it had all these photos in it, and amongst them, this was in here. So these are previously unseen photos of Mark animating Snow White at the Hyperion Studio in 37. There's a picture of Walt and
Seth. You probably know he was an assistant to Grip Natwick,
right,
who was working on Snow White, which required the utmost, the top level draftsmanship, which is why Mark was brought in here for him.
Yeah, so that's Grim down there on the right, standing in those kind of natty outfits. So there's some amazing photos, but the thing that kind of really surprised me that I didn't know before I really dove into this project was that Mark, I always assumed, started in the early 60s, which he did in official capacity. But Walt actually had him design things for opening day Disneyland as well. So this is Mark's design for the Golden Shoe Oleo from 1955 that he drew up for him. And Alice told us that he would actually, Walt would pull him off of, you know, projects he was animating occasionally to work on these things.
So it got to be a little bit lumpy in terms of what was being done. Sometimes there'd be work and sometimes there wasn't. So Mark, being multi-talented, could kind of fill in anywhere.
The guy could kind of do anything. And then this was really amazing. So there was a group of people who were part of a thing called the Penthouse Club.
Yeah.
What do you know about the Penthouse Club?
Well, I've seen pictures of it. Apparently, it was you had to make above a certain amount of money to be allowed in. And then it was on the roof of the building, and you could go sun yourself. There's nude sunbathing, and I don't know why you'd want to do that. But
So the Penthouse Club members actually walked through a pre-opening party for them at Disneyland while it was under construction. So this is 2 weeks before Disneyland opens, and Mort Kimball came in full costume attire. They fired up the E.P. Ripley and the Mark Twain. And we don't know who that lady is that Mark's with, but it was someone he was dating before he got with Alice. But these are incredible. These are all photos that Mark took. This is 2 weeks before opening. And coming off the Shanghai project, this gives me a heart attack. Par for the course, I guess, for these guys. Okay. So this is a photo of Mark and Alice's living room, and the whole house is absolutely chock full of Papua New Guinea art museums mixed with Mark's artwork, which is just kind of overwhelming. But I always assumed, and incorrectly, that all this Papua New Guinea artifacts and collecting that he and Alice did really drove his designs for the Enchanted Tiki Room and for the Jungle Cruise, but actually he didn't collect any of these things until after he designed one of those attractions. Now let's take a look at the Jungle Cruise. Of course, it's a completely iconic Disneyland attraction and parks around the world. here's Marc actually doing a later version of it in his office for Florida, for Walt Disney World. And we just want to take a look at some of the artwork that Marc has done. I mean, look at this gorgeous, beautiful rendering. It's so simple and clear, and the staging is so good. That's, for me, the two of the big things, and there are many things that strike me about Marc's artwork, is the staging, and then the slight caricature that he gives. These are supposed to be real animals, but they all have kind of a slight whimsy to them, a cuteness to them. I mean, what do you, as an animator, what do you...
I feel like, I mean, I was, of course, drawn to Marc's amazing draftsmanship, but then as you look at his stuff, there's all his ideas behind it. It's not just the drawing of an elephant. It's the interaction or the idea of what's happening in there that I think made him so valuable. Because, of course, the public would never see these drawings, right? These are just guides for what you will see. So there's got to be something of substance in there. He's just amazing.
And I just think it's so clear, it's readability. That was one of the things I asked him a lot when I was thinking about wanting to do theme park design someday. As I say, it's got to read clear. And absolutely. All of his drawings are like that. The other thing that's really cool for me is on the right there, there's this, he did these animation patterns for Mako, the machine shop, to build these figures, basically key frames of the animation people to see.
Yeah, to try to get more realistic movement in terms of, because Marc was, of course, an amazing anatomist. He taught students and could draw from memory, like, the structure, the skeletal structure of deer, of almost any animal.
Yeah.
So he just had this encyclopedic knowledge in his head.
Yeah. And I have not seen any examples of anyone at WED or Imagineering doing key frames of animation. I think they kind of did the sculpt and got it happy, but they didn't really think about what it was going to move like. Marc was really instrumental in this. So here's Walt backstage at Disneyland with one of Marc's elephants, the mama elephant. And again, you can really see that Disney whimsy there, that like kind of cuteness to it. Yeah, even though it's a real animal.
Yeah, if you put it, I mean, when you see it, I think generally my response is, oh, it's an elephant. It looks like a realistic elephant. If you put it next to a real elephant, you would notice where they're stretching and distorting and you know, caricature.
Absolutely. So one of the great things about this project is, believe it or not, Marc came to lecture at Imagineering several times in the early 80s. There were these very old videotapes that were actually starting to go to rot, and we were really fortunate we were able to get them transferred and preserved. So let's hear what Marc has to say about doing the elephants for the Jungle Cruise.
The next thing that worked on was the Jungle River ride. I spent, well, after Lincoln and a few other things in between, I did some work on Nature's Wonderland. I did some kind of a rehab on the sub-ride and so on, but this was really kind of the first big kind of job of love. So anyway, did the elephant pool, and these are little explorations of things, again, something that an elephant, our elephants could do that you wouldn't see with a real elephant. And matter of fact, I remember somebody went through there one day and a couple of LA ladies said, well, you can tell me those big elephants aren't real, but those little elephants are real. So we had them doing things, you know, like two sprays on the trunk and so forth and so on. Anyway, this was a very interesting thing that happened because I designed this pool. Wayne Gibson's magnificent sculptors, maquettes of these things, we put it all together. And then one day we went down there to see the thing, and God, I couldn't look at this, and there were so many elephants in that pool. And I thought, because again, knowing Walt Disney, and he was such a bear on how you stage something, things being staged right, things telling the story properly. And the first thing I said to him, I said, well, there's one thing you're probably not going to like, Paul, I said, is that is that nobody can go through here and see all these elephants all the time. He says, and this again is how things begin to happen. He said, God, that's great. He says, so the next time they come through, they'll see something new the second time.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. Every time you write these attractions, you kind of see things. Oh, I never noticed that before. It's great. So Marc was a big proponent in actually coming up with new ideas. So when they replicated the attractions in Florida and Tokyo, he would try to come up with new ideas for new scenes that we didn't have here in Anaheim. And I kind of love this sketch here, but I love even more the one on the right. That is a note to Wathel Rogers, who was working out in the field in terms of his staging and how exactly how he wanted to place everything. So he was very controlling. And then these are the warriors in Florida. So Mark's kind of pretending to figure finish here on the character. And again, these ones had a more Papua New Guinea feel to them. So there's more of an African character, just kind of one.
Yeah, he can track his knowledge of Papua New Guinea as he goes forward.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then one of the things we're super excited to bring you guys in this book is Mark was a machine. Mark did a plethora of gags and ideas for all these attractions that most people have never seen before. And in most cases, they're just as strong as the ones that made it into the final show.
Like this one, for example, you can see it's similar in sort of its composition to, say, like, it was like chasing the guys up the pole, so they probably said, well, it's a little redundant. So.
Right, right. I love the look on that parrot's face. It's like, ah, yeah, good luck. And he was going to do a graveyard of elephants, which was kind of interesting. That never came to fruition. And then we found some great photos. This is, it's not looking forward. There we go. Here he is with Bill Justice and the Florida model for the Jungle Cruise. They're holding one of Mark's renderings. And then,
how about that thing over on the right there?
Yeah, so what that thing on the right Mark's looking into, it looks like a doctor's equipment of some sort. It's a little scope that actually Fred Jerger in the model shop developed. And it's got a little 45-degree mirror inside, and what it does is when you look in the eye hole, it gives you the guest view. So if you're working on a very small model, it gives you kind of that view that you don't get looking from the top down. We still use these today in engineering. In fact, I made a little paper one for the Sinbad ride for Tokyo Disney some years ago, so they're very, very helpful. So in amongst the ideas that Mark pitched, this is one that broke his heart. He really wanted to have out there. This was a man-eating plant. And I remember him saying, this was way before Little Shop of Horrors. And this is going to be burping and belching as he went by with human bones around it, kind of grim. And he could never sell it. So I thought it kind of died with Mark's sketch. But we actually found that when you zoom in on the model of the Florida Jungle Cruise, there are actual animal plants in there. Sorry. And then believe it or not, it was actually on the production schedule for a short time. So as late as March of 1969, those many plants were slated to be sculpted and gone into production and made. Something happened, we're not sure what, but those went away, and so Mark replaced them with these giant frogs, which are found in the Amazon. And this was all going to take place at the rainforest in Florida. So they actually went into production and made these giant frogs. And these are the documentation photos of them before they installed them. So they're very cute, Marc Davis. But what's kind of this weird little sidebar is apparently they were out there in the jungle for about a year, croaking and such, and then someone decided to remove them, but someone forgot to turn off the audio. So when you went through the rainforest, there were all these frogs croaking off of you, but you couldn't see them. So they're still there. I didn't hear them last time I went, so I guess they got fixed that. Yeah. So Mark was a big proponent of actually going out to the field and actually taking a look at the staging he did, especially in terms of Anaheim, because he could just drive right down the 5 freeway and go check it out. So here he is in the trough during a refresh. And this next footage is amazing. There's no audio on it, so we put some Jungle Cruise noises on it, but this is incredible. So this is from the 1976 refresh of the Jungle Cruise, and that's Fred Jerger and Michael Rogers. Mark is down there. They're about a month away from opening the new scenes for Jungle Cruise, and Mark is actually checking out the staging and getting notes from the other actors about what he'd like to see. And I wish we had audio on this because I'd love to hear what he's saying there. To me, this is absolutely shocking footage because this is the master imagineer at work in his element. You know, you can almost hear him say, "Whoa, as I say, this is poor staging here." This is great. I mean, how good is this? That's awesome. Yeah, it's really the only way to work. There you go. Better. We gotta get a lip reader to tell me. So for me, this is absolutely amazing because I didn't think any of this kind of footage existed when we found it for this project. So wind back a little bit. For those of you who don't know, WED. Engineering was actually based at Walt Disney Studios in Burbank until the early 1960s when Walt realized that they needed to move off property and actually have their own space. And they moved to where we are today in Glendale. In 1961, they moved to this building that's known as the 800 Sonora Building. And it's still there today. We still use it for various projects. It does not have that A-frame out front, but all the concrete bricks are still there. Pretty neat building. And it says WED on the outside, and Alice Davis told us they had the worst time because people were constantly calling and saying, right, are you a wedding shop? Because I want to order a wedding dress. People didn't know what WED was, so they would, you know, people driving by in Glendale thought, well, what's going on inside there? Well, these amazing photos we just been working show you what was going on inside there. What was going on inside 800 Sonora was Walt and his team of WED engineers were actually designing the enchanted Tiki Room, early Jungle Cruise, all four shows for the New York World's Fair, and then the earliest versions of the Pirates of the Caribbean, which was a wax museum at that time.
Again, these photos have never been seen. They were taken from Look magazine,
right?
Not used.
Yeah.
And Chris discovered big storehouse.
And then this just kills me. This is the WED wrecking crew. Quad coats, rolling from Lane Gibson, Yale, Gracie. Mark is actually pitching his ideas for the gags for the toys. It's a small world, which Rolly Crump would build later on. So that's why he's.
It's just great to see them act. It's not staged. They're not posing or mugging. You know, it's actual. Just doing the job.
Yeah, and Roger Brogan there looks a little worried about. Here he is talking to Dick Irvine. In the back of the background, that's Harriet Burns. That's their little break room with little vending machines and such. And believe it or not, this is Bob Gurr. And he's there with Ken O'Brien and Dick Irvine and Brogy, and he's showing Walt his new idea. They were in production on Lincoln for the World's Fair, so Bob had come up with a new way to animate Lincoln's arm and was pitching it to him. He told us this didn't really work out so well for him. And here's Walt looking at the Small World model with Quad Coats leaning over his shoulder, and that's Colin Campbell in the background, and Dick Irvine and Mark. These photos are absolutely flabbergasting to me. Because they're not posing, right? They're not staged. They're actually at work in these images. Here's Harry Burns and Joyce Carlson. They're actually feathering the Tiki Birds for the Tiki Room show. It was really great. That's probably one of my favorite all-time Disneyland classics. And Mark had a heavy, heavy hand in the design of it, particularly in the verses. And back to what we were saying about the elephants before, you know, they've got that slight character, right? So they're real birds, but they've got that Disney whimsy, that Disney touch.
And I think one of the things by looking at these sketches, which we're coming to, you start to realize, as an audience member, you kind of go to the Tiki Room and you think, oh, it must have just came out of his head that way, like first try. No, you can see he's exploring a lot of different ideas, even in terms of like how realistic or how cartoon to go. Definitely in terms of the entertainment of what's happening.
Yeah, these are some rough sketches we found in Mark's office for the Tiki Reapers. And you can see the ones that he liked, he circled. He would do that on his rough pencils or ink sketches. And then, of course, we have the final artwork at Walt Disney Engineering today. So look how charming and appealing that is. So again, it's got clear staging, readability. Mark Davis masterpiece, really. Look at those cute little caiques up there, smiling and bobbing. Really, really fun stuff. And then, you know, this is kind of interesting. Maybe you can speak to this, but Mark didn't just do, quote unquote, normal realistic birds. He actually went off and explored a bit, did these kind of wacky, strange, left field things. Now, I mean, I think about like what you guys did on Monsters, Inc. and coming up with crazy ideas.
Yeah, well, like we were saying, you know, what's in the show was the result of a lot of exploration. And Mark makes a point, not only in the Tiki Room, but almost everything he worked on, is saying, I want to explore this thing from every angle. I'm going to try a bunch of different things before you arrive on the solution, which is exactly the way we're working today, both at Imagineering and at still.
Yeah, I think it's an important part. You have to kind of actually force yourself, because a lot of times you don't necessarily have time to do explorations like this, but I think you owe it to yourself and yes, to explore every opportunity.
So it's been quite a different Tiki Room.
Yeah, but yeah, Rolly Crump actually said he made one of these wacky birds and said it came out really bad, and Walt hated it. He says, hey, you stick to the Tiki sculpting. So let's hear what Mark has to say about working on the Tiki Room show.
So the thing was that we began to, or at least I began to form a kind of my own philosophy of what an audio animatronic show was in a park such as Disneyland or Disney World, or simply in Tokyo. One thing, nobody wants to stay in one attraction very long. And not staying in one attraction very long, you want to give a lot of show and a short space of time. But what we really found, what I found here, was this show is built with a series of surprises. You do not know what's going to happen. You go in there and there's some birds, and I would say you can certainly assume that the birds are going to come to life. It's pretty obvious that they would. I may not have an exact order, but when these big bowls that hold the flowers come down, the flowers begin to sing. And then the kind of key flowers come up and sing solo. Again, this is, it's a surprise. It's what you did not expect to see. And then finally the ceiling opens up and this birdmobile comes down. And then finally the whole room comes to life. Now this is, to me, this is the most exciting part of the show is when this, I guess it's a wild war dance, comes on and black the room out and light, you know, and lightning flashes. And then even the wall decorations come to life. The poles that are holding up the building come to life. And I think this is really the extraordinary thing. Now this was the first sketch I think I did when we were only gonna have maybe two heads on these. And we finally ended up with three heads. And this was a more or less a finished sketch that I did. And these are based on New Guinea art. The only thing is that I have taken a lot of liberties with them.
So I love those Tiki Room poles. Some of Mark's original sketches, roughs for them. And again, he started with kind of a more African look, but then he got into Papua New Guinea look again pretty quickly. These are beautifully staged and really well done. I big highlight of the show for me. And then just digging, we went through our show quality standards department, and they had all this documentation. And we found all these Polaroids that were kind of falling apart, so thankfully we got the visual. That's really Crump, actually sculpting the clay of that Tiki Room pole at 800 Sonora.
And he said he hadn't sculpted before the show.
Right, right.
He just said, somebody got
to
do it. So.
Yeah, he talked to Wayne Gibson about it, and he said, well, are you going to sculpt it? He goes, no, I'm too busy. He said, you're going to sculpt it. She's like, okay, here we go. I love these, and especially that other photo of Walt. I mean, who hasn't on their way out trying to put their finger in? And this is kind of fun to look at. So when you look at Mark's original sketch for the Tiki drummers above the windows there, you notice that Mark designed them as monkeys with tails on them. But when Rolly got to sculpting them, he omitted the tails from them, took them off, and kind of came up with a more stylized look than Mark really designed here. But then by the time you get to Florida, the Tiki drummers, Mark has snapped to Rolly's design. If they actually existed, they had tooling and had to remake the exact same ones. So, by the way, the quality of this artwork is really, really beautiful. Vanessa Hunt, who's our book designer for this, works in our art gallery, and amazing. She did the Disneyland poster book. And they're going through a major effort. They're re-scanning their whole collection. So these are all brand new scans of Mark's original artwork, so the color is like you've never seen before. Anyway, here's the little windows in Florida. This is a mock-up. In our facility in Glendale, and it's made out of paper. It shows the volcanoes exploding in the background, so that was something they added. And then the pre-show, I think, is really charming for Florida. You've got this waterfall, and it parts, and these toucans talk to you in the pre-show. It's so charming and well thought out, well staged, you know. So this is kind of fun. This is Wadeville Rogers, and he's got that artwork that we just showed you by Mark in hand. He's taking one of the Tiki drummers, and they're mocking up toucans for the pre-show in Florida. And I thought this was kind of an interesting photo. But then when I looked at it in Photoshop, I thought, what's going on behind him back there? There's some sort of amorphous figure. So I zoomed in and lightened it in Photoshop. And believe it or not, ladies and gentlemen, this is a lost ghost from the Haunted Mansion. This is the squeaky door ghost. So we've got like another hatbox ghost situation. And it's a ghost that they planned for the Haunted Mansion, but they never put in. This is the artwork that Mark did for it, and it's really kind of 1930s spook house ghost in a French maid outfit. And what she's doing, Mark's notes say she's adding sweets to the door. I would love to see us put this back in.
Looks like she's stepping through the door there.
Right. All right, so let's talk about one of the best attractions of all time, Pirates of the Caribbean. Focus on it on this expo this year, and Mark was a master of this. This is our 1401 Flower Street model. It looks very much like this today. Actually, those airlines on the wall in the back you can still find, which is kind of fun to go see. And what we've done is we've gone back and we've actually pulled the original negatives from some of these photo shoots to get these alternate. This is kind of an iconic picture. But we want to really give you a sense of seeing some things that you haven't seen before. And this is something that certainly no one's ever seen before. We found this in Mark's desk drawer. These are Mark's handwritten notes for when Walt had him do the wax museum version of Pirates of the Caribbean.
Did a lot of research, just like we do now.
It goes on for like 40 pages. So he went into the library and checked out all these books on pirates. And before he designed the scenes for this wax museum walkthrough, he wanted to assign personalities to them. So this is his rough sketch that is at the house. And then here's the final artwork we have in the art library collection. So you can see he's coming up with little narratives and tableaus.
I like one of his notes is, wrathful casualties are higher than...
Right. And then this is an image that I saw a lot. This was in that souvenir guidebook that you used to be able to buy that's filled with Mark's drawings on pirates. And so when we were doing research in the library, we thought, well, let's check out all the books that Mark checked out on pirates. So this is a book from the 1850s called Pirate's Own Book. And it's filled with kind of woodcut illustrations on it. And our jaws hit the floor when we saw this drawing. So for sure, Mark referenced this.
Yeah.
Pretty great. So for those of you who don't know, again, the walkthrough was an early, early version of Pirates of the Caribbean. And the idea was that you were going to go down into this sub-basement area of New Orleans Square, and you were going to see these little tableaus, these little vignettes that Mark had designed. Claude Coates did a version of it. And there were going to be these little scenes where lights were going to come on and off, and figures were going to animate, but not probably to the level that they did in the final attraction. So Mark did a couple of different stabs at these, and what I like to do is zoom in really close on some of the artwork. And if you know Mark's artwork, some of these scenes match up, so you actually get a sense of what he was going to put where. So like this treasure chest thing down here, I think this matches up with that pretty nicely. And again, clear statement, right? And then in and amongst the notes, the other thing that was kind of interesting is Mark had a whole series of gags with these strong women pirates that he was going to do. So these are historical figures. Anne Bonny and Mary Read were actual real women pirates. In fact, he talks about in his notes how they chastised the rest of the crew for being cowards while they were the ones who were fighting off the British Navy there. And Mark was going to use them in a couple of scenes in the Wax Museum that never happened. And here they are getting the lion's share of the loot while the rest of the guys are getting little coins and looking a little put out. And then later here they're just getting all the treasure and dressing themselves up. I love the staging on this. But then also, I was looking at the skeletons and I went, wait a minute. Where have we seen those skeletons before? So of course, when the Wax Museum went away and they had this big space, this grotto to fill up with things, Mark went back and reused his skeleton sketches from the earlier version. So he never kind of threw anything away. This is another one I really like. This is a really strong cat shadow, Sir Henry Morgan. I always love this illustration.
Well, the heads on the left, I mean, all his drawings are great, but then they also have this just wonderful specificity of character.
Right.
You know, in just a few lines. And it's, again, that great balance between real enough,
yeah,
but definitely character.
And it's really simple, too. You know, it's not, he's not laboring over this. And he was a machine. There were so many of these that he did. So what's interesting is Mark actually did some work on the Wax Museum, and then he got really busy with the New York World's Fair. He actually worked on all four shows. So while he was doing that, there was a gentleman from animation named Ken O'Connor, who was kind of his assistant at Imagineering. And so he took a bunch of Mark's sketches and laid them out in scenes for the Wax Museum. So believe it or not, this rough by Ken has no less than 7 Marc Davis gags that shoehorned into them. So see if you can match them up. And then the other kind of neat thing for me was, before they did the full show model, they actually did a quarter-inch scale paper model that there's a few photos of. And if you zoom in, there's actually Marc Davis gags that never made it into the final show. And then if you look there on the right, there's that cast shadow for Sir Henry Morgan. So I believe that they were going to put that there. Because I remember writing as a little kid and going by, you know, the bombing of the fort and seeing this kind of dead space out there. So I think they had that plan from there. Hard to know, but it's kind of neat. And then who's this guy? Bill Justice.
Yeah, that's Bill. I was looking at the back a second. But yeah, so this is, as they're starting to get into animated figures, which I just love all the electronics and the equipment back
right
there. Just like they did with the live action films, they did a lot of live action reference. I'm sorry. Just like they did with the animated films.
Right, yeah.
Stuff like Peter Pan, Cinderella, they shot all this in live action, which aided the animators a lot. And
And then I'm like, oh my gosh, there's Mark's drawing as reference for the actor there in the background reflected in the mirror. Pretty cool.
How they animated these things is crazy. So look at this. This is the CAM system that would basically each one of those little discs controls one articulation, one movement, say the arm up, down, or the elbow bend, or whatever. Each one of those is one. And there are little, if you look closely, you can see little dents inside. And when it goes in, that would actuate then the audio animatronic. And so they would sit there and carve these things. I think you said they were out of cardboard.
Yeah, they would make them out of paper or cardboard and keep playing with them, like, oh, I carved too much here. Now I got to tape some more back in to get the movement just right. They did it what they wanted, then we had a pattern. And then they would go to the machine shop and actually make these things. But what they used, a lot of what I learned, Sony, is everyone was encouraged to bring in their old 78s. And because they were the perfect size, 78 RPM records, for those of you who know what I'm saying.
So then that whole spindle would rotate, and then that way the movement just never ends. It just loops back around. And this actually goes way back to old mechanical musical instruments,
right,
that they kind of pulled that idea from.
So they mocked up the entire auction scene in what we call our high bays in our 1401 facility in Glendale, Mississippi. We actually matched up exactly where this is by looking at all the junk in the ceiling there. It's still all there in the same space. So we know exactly where they staged this. And they showed this to Walt right before he passed, and he bought off on it and approved it. And the way you can tell that you're looking at a mock-up of it and not the ride is all the animals are plywood cutouts. Because Orlando Ferrante told us the animals were the last in production, so they weren't ready to go for that mock-up. So this is an absolutely incredible shot that we found. It was misfiled. That's Mark on the left and Bill Justice, and then Jack Taylor in the middle is projecting the live action. And then Wayful Rogers is working on the scalpels. It's all in Imagineering in Glendale. It's amazing. This was really cool too. So there was a company called Aero Development, for those of you who don't know, and they actually designed a lot of the early vehicles for Disneyland. And they designed, I think, the Small World vehicle, and they actually did the boats for pirates. So this was actually up in their former facility in Mountain View, California, and they were doing the boats for pirates. And one day Walt got his wrecking crew of WED Imagineers, and they all came up. And this is amazing because they're all there. Dick Irvine, Ex Atencio, Claude Coates, Joe Fowler in the front there. And here they are testing down. And you can just see Mark peeking out back in between Dick Irvine and Claude Coates there. So this is an amazing photo that the son of the man who started Aero shared with us. And then in Mark's closet, we found all these photos, and then Mark took this photo as they went down the drop, back in Claude Coates' hat. One thing that Mark really wanted to change when they got to Florida was he did not care for how the Anaheim Pirates ended. He thought it was kind of a miss, and he wanted to come up with a big, beautiful finale scene where he got off the boat. And so this is this treasure room scene. And so Mark, here he is working at it in his office. There's a series of, they're now kind of executive offices. We call it the Gold Coast at Imaginary. It's right on the street there. So Mark used to have an office on the Gold Coast right up there. So that's what he's doing here.
It's funny to listen to him because I know they were not fond of the caves at the beginning.
Right.
Or the ending. Those are the things to me that make it such a great attraction.
Yeah, absolutely. They thought, like, oh, the caves were a mistake. You spent way too long down there. But I've always liked it because it kind of feels like slipping into a dream and stepping out of a dream as it's in. But regardless, they changed it up for Florida. Mark did, of course, his trademark amazing staging, all these drunk pirates kind of rolling around in the loop. But let's hear Mark what he has to say about the end of the Florida version.
The thing that bothered me with Mark right here is the fact that the ride was over at the bottom of that up there, and is over the bottom of it. Then you have to go ratchety, ratchety, ratchety all the way to the top. Then you're going to measure the pitch back there. Then you wait and you wonder, well, what are we going to do next year? How the hell are we going to get off of here? And I think that, to me, that great amusement of the attraction away from it. And so when we did the Florida one, I wanted to use a speed ramp to get people up and unload them from bottom. So what I did was to do that scene, which turned out pretty much like this, a big treasury, an awful lot to see. And anyway, to do a parrot that could sing the song in its entirety here, we can hear all of it, and enough stuff to look at on the outside, and just nutty things here. and even to these figures, which are inside. And the reason they're the color that they are, I want everything inside of that room there to be gold. I want that to look rich, everything. So I didn't use any cool colors on that. I had the khakis and the yellows and the golds and yellow rope and what have you. And I think there's an effectiveness in that of, as I say again, it's making a complete visual statement. Something we can do perhaps better than anybody else.
Always great to hear Marc's work, by the way. So we mentioned before, we're going to show you a lot of things you've never seen before. There's a whole chapter devoted to unrealized attractions. So this is a kind of wacky one. This was planned for the Fort Wilderness area of Florida, this funhouse that he was going to do. And it's really strange. It never made it. It is the house of former chicken farmers. And these are the proprietors with their big rooster. Call that a bantam rooster, I'm not sure. And the idea would be that you'd come into their house and you go into the lobby and you'd see their ghosts up on the balcony up above, and you'd explore their house at your leisure. So, and it had traditional funhouse, mystery spot kind of things, like a wacky shack library that would rock back and forth, and the old tilted room gag with the pool balls and a shark in a tank. And there was a mirror maze where the proprietors would appear and disappear, and the rooster would be crowing at you. And then you had this conservatory that you walked through with these really strange, like, Muppet-like plants. And Marc's notes on it say that there was going to be a light fog put along the bottom, and you'd walk along this squishy material, which I'm sure operations would have loved. And then another, this is so amazing. Vanessa Hunt just turned all this stuff up. Marc designed a silly symphony star cry that he pitched that never made it. And it's amazing. And it's a little, you know, it's a little secret dark cry, but it's got like a skeleton dance scene and a Who Killed Cock Robin scene. And it's got
a there's a Joe Grant, for example, was really fond of all the silly symphony. So the idea of putting it together into an attraction would have been fun.
Yeah. And I just, this piece of artwork is amazing. This was actually a misfile somewhere. Tom Morris found it and brought it back to the art library. But the staging and the color on this is completely incredible. I remember Mike Giambo used to give us an assignment at CalArts to do a character in silhouette. If it read in silhouette, then you knew you had a good, strong pose in your design. You can see this whole drawing is full of really good, strong poses.
Not only that, just the way your eye goes. I bet everybody immediately goes to the grasshopper, and then you just follow those characters along like that path. So it's really well controlled. It's beautiful.
Yeah, I'm excited to show you guys more of this. And then this is really interesting. Right before Marc retired, Marc had this idea that he wasn't able to sell. Marc was a big proponent of indigenous cultures, and especially Native American cultures. And he loved, Native Americans used to make these little dolls. They called them Kachina dolls, for those of you who don't know. And Marc wanted to take the Grand Canyon diorama at Disneyland, which you see on the train ride, and in the primeval world with the dinosaurs from the World's Fair, and swap them out with Kachina dolls. And I don't know how far he would have gotten with this, but he did do a series of really beautiful illustrations for it. So here he is talking about it.
On the wall around here are some new dioramas that I've designed for railroad train. And again, I'm going to do something that people have not seen before. I haven't seen before. And what I want to do here, get rid of any painted back. What you see here is all in the midst. The sky behind would be partially front projection, partially rear projection. Real live action clouds. When you look at these little figures against the luminosity, this again should give us kind of magic that if we can make it work, I'm sure we can. Very, very different from any kind of diorama anybody else could see.
So this was kind of fascinating because I wasn't aware that he actually was going to do this, and I wish that I'd known about it back when he was alive. I would ask him a million questions about it. But when we started on this project, a gentleman named Glenn Barker, who used to just retire, he ran our audio department there. I was talking to him about the book, and I said, "Oh yeah, you know, we're going to talk about this Kachina diorama that Marc wanted to do." He said, "Oh, you know, I was around when we did that. We actually did a scratch track for the Kachina diorama." I said, "Really?" I said, "Well, God, we would love to hear that. Can you take a look?" And he took a look, he said, "That doesn't exist anymore, it's lost to the ages, sorry." And so I'm like, "Oh, okay, fine." Then we were at Alice's house, and going through Mark's record hutch and found a stack of cassettes, and in amongst them, this cassette was there. And I asked Alice, I said, can you please borrow this? And she goes, oh my goodness. So we borrowed it and we brought it back, and Glenn said, oh my gosh, that's my handwriting. I must have made a scratch track copy for Mark back in the 70s. So what we've done is we've digitized the audio on this and matched it up with the artwork to kind of give you a little sense of what it would have been like to ride with Puccini.
Get on the train now.
Yeah, let's get on the train and let's go see Mark's Puccini.
In the land of the mesas, the Puccini is the spirit of the sun, the stars, and the planets. Called Yunya and Yunyamana, prickly pear Puccinis cause the springs to run fresh and clean and pure. Puccina is a symbol of nature's harmony. The deer, the wolf, the hornet, the horned toad, the pronghorn, the horned owl, are all a part of nature's tapestry. The mudhead clowns, like all clowns, wish to make people laugh. This lonesome coyote is talking to his friends. Maybe he's asking who's for dinner. This roadrunner would probably prefer a toad or a lizard, but sometimes he has to settle for a rattlesnake. One of the desert's miracles is the thunderstorm. A year's rain may fall in one night. And that's a lot of rain.
So pretty fascinating. You never got very far.
But of all the desert's magic, nothing is more awesome and nothing more beautiful than a desert sunset.
So we got somewhere. Another really interesting attraction that he did that people don't know about, this is a photo of Mark with Ray Bradbury there on the left, and that's Erwin Costello.
Yeah, he did the orchestrations and arrangements for, Mary Poppins.
Thank you, yes. Well, here, this is a photo when they were actually re-recording the Fantasia soundtrack, but Mark and Ray Bradbury actually worked on this attraction together. Ray Bradbury wrote this whole script for it. And the only reason it still exists is because Mark saved the script and put it in the art library.
So this photo was probably taken as they were re-recording
Fantasia. Right. So this attraction that they did, it was called the Yestermorrow Time Machine, and it's crazy. This was for the Monsanto Corporation. It was designed to replace the Carousel of Progress. And it's just this nutty thing, and it's filled with Babylonian and Sumerian gods and talking furniture that comes to life. And here's some of Mark's roughs for the talking furniture. And Mark did a ton of work on this project. He did something like 85 boards for it. So here he is in his office pitching it to Dick Irvine and Art Walker going through it. But what's interesting to me about this is it's so intense. If you read the Ray Bradbury script, there's this recurring motif of fire. It goes through it out, like, Tribal Man reaches up and grabs fire! And it's just like, whoa, wait a second. You can almost see like the Monsanto executives like taking a look at this and going, we were hoping we were gonna do Great Big Beautiful tomorrow, or something like that. Never happened. But the other amazing lost attraction that we would have all loved to see was the Western River Expedition to Walt Disney World. Absolutely gorgeous colors, incredible. And one thing that most people are not aware of is the big influence of how much work Mary Blair did on the attraction. So Mary and Mark were good friends, or they are having cocktails at Mary's house.
You can see what you can recreate your martini there.
Right. And look at the color sensibility that Mary has. This is absolutely incredible. So she was the color stylist, and actually Vanessa turned up, believe it or not, the color keys. He Mary had pulled color chips for this whole thing. They were like ready to go into production on it.
These are like gels, right? Layers of gels, are they that?
I believe so, and little cutouts. I think some of them might be tissue glued to it. I know she worked with a variety of materials. But an undeniable influence on what Mark was doing. And the idea was that at a certain point, you'd be in this canyon in between the buttes, and the sun would be going down, and the peak, the rays of the sun would just be hitting the top of the canyons. So you really have these cools playing against your warms, literally the definition of playing the warms against your cools.
This attraction had just, it's Pirates of the Caribbean or unimagined level
right.
gags and characters. It would have been absolutely fantastic.
I mean, look at that, and there's the Marc Davis number. He's kind of the guy who really brought humor to Disneyland.
Yeah.
He was fairly serious before. So this is great. That's Dave Swinninger and Ken O'Brien working on the maquettes, and then Fred Jerger. And this model was absolutely fantastic. And again, Mary Blair's color sense, you can see it really reading through in the final painted version.
So this got all the way, they made a model.
They made a model.
Recreated what that whole ride would have been.
Yeah, and they've got schematics and blueprints, and they were ready to go. And it had different rides integrated with it. And at a certain point, they had a little runaway train attached to the show building, and that runaway train turned into Tony Baxter's Big Thunder Mountain Railroad eventually. And at a certain point, it just became Big Thunder Mountain Railroad, and this went away.
It was an interesting concept, too, because while you're in the boat going through, you could see the train, so these rides would sort of intersect.
Multi-level stuff, so it would have been great. It kind of broke Mark's heart that we never made this. He was so hopeful up until all the time that he passed that maybe Tokyo would be interested in. So let's hear what Mark has to say about the Western River Expedition.
What you see here is the beginning of any idea that I do. I do an awful lot of roughs that are looking and searching for ideas. These sometimes are developed as small things, sometimes large, and the things that you'll see in a couple of moments all began this way. I feel that I want many ideas done by myself to be able to pick and choose. I think it's much better than just having one thing and saying that's it. I like to try every possibility that there is in a drawing or in an idea, staging the character, try to intensify the humor of the drama that it may have. So this is kind of, as I say, you're beginning to see the very, very beginnings of how I...
So this footage is flabbergasting to me because here he is in his office. You're seeing him create it right before your eyes, which is absolutely incredible. So there's the rough of that final, another horse-banded gag. And again, it was great for Pete and I and Vanessa to explore Mark's house and find he kept a lot of these rough sketches at his home himself. So there's the rough for the next one he's going to flip to in a second. Not sure what they ever did with this footage. It was for an in-house video publication that never really seemed to happen. And so, in the spirit of things that never happened before, this was shocking to me too. I thought he did this in the mid to late 60s. There was an attraction called Garden of the Gods that Mark worked on. And here he is in his animation office in D-Wing at the studio. This is from 1960, and he's actually working on this piece of artwork. We saw the final one today. So, for those of you who don't know what the Garden of the Gods was, the Garden of the Gods was this really charming attraction that Mark wanted to do. It was going to be a very slow-moving boat ride. And it was going to take place about where the motorboat crews used to be, over by the Matterhorn. And you would go through all these statues of Greek mythology. You would see all these beautiful fountains and things. And Mark, of course, the importance of research can't be overstated here. So here he is listing all the Greek gods and goddesses and characters from Greek mythology and assigning attributes to them, coming up with ideas for the act. And I mean, I know that we do this at Imagineering. I'm sure you guys do this at Pixar all the time. Love these rough sketches, exploratory things. And then the final one, really, really beautiful. We believe that the animation would have been a little limited on this. Most of the movement would have come out of the water features in this. And then there was this one scene, Mark described this as going down into hell. So this was the mouth of to Hades, and you can char on Pharaoh's souls over the River Styx, and the Cerberus, the three-headed dog, was there in the foreground. So Mark was always exploring lots of things, different ideas. So I want to give you guys, show you guys something. See how long it takes you to guess what Mark is actually working out on the design here. So he is doing a little exploratory sketch. So here's a rough sketch we've done in Mark's office. This is for a painting. And this is a lady on an old-fashioned bicycle, one of the big wheels. tables up in front. So it's okay, it's kind of not that funny, but whatever. Well, what if this lady is standing on a chair and she's scared by the whole house? Like, that's kind of cute, but I don't know, let's see. Well, I'll give her a parasol. I'll give her a parasol, and then like, oh, she'll see herself like reflecting with her. Well, I kind of like the parasol, but that's not that funny. Well, maybe if I put her on a building, that's kind of silly. And well, let's keep the parasol. I like the parasol, that's good. What if she's in danger? Like, maybe she's being menaced by a crocodile or something. Right, like, oh, that'd be kind of cool. And, like, yeah, I really like that gag. That's a good gag. I'm going to take that to a tight pencil line and rough it in. Well, yeah, I really like that a lot. I'm going to do a concept painting of that and give it to my friend Ed Cohn, who's going to make the full size of the stretching portrait for her on a mansion. So it's pretty neat to see Mark's thought process going through it. As artists and designers, I always love to get into another artist's head and kind of see what they're thinking and how they arrive.
Absolutely. That's what's going to be so great about the book, is being able to see it.
Yeah. Did we say we're excited? So let's learn a little bit more about the Haunted Mansion from Mark and Walt.
Mark, I want you to meet Julie Reed. This is Marc Davis. Julie is Miss Disneyland and setting. And Marc Davis is the master in charge of our House of Illusions, or what do we call it?
Haunted Mansion.
Haunted Mansion and Supernatural. So you really like me? What are you going to have in there?
Yes, well, we're doing a lot of portraits that change right in front of your very eyes. As a matter of fact, one of our paintings here is based on Greek mythology. This is Medusa. It's a very beautiful girl. She offended the goddess Athena. And as a result, Athena turned her into a gorgon. And as you may know, if you looked at a gorgon would turn you into stone.
Well, we should have wanted that to happen. What is, tell about this thing here, Levi.
Well, this is our elongating stretching room. And in this room, we also have some stretching portraits. Perhaps you'd like to look at those over there. These are some that
you pull them down, you should see what happens when the room gets longer, you get these full-size portraits.
Davis, one of Walt's nine old men, so much more than an animator. I absolutely love this stuff. Come on, attractions that never happened. Thank you guys for listening to Sam's Disney Diary, the D23 Expo. Absolutely incredible. More to come, believe it or not. Don't forget the Disney Arts Podcast. We will see you next time. Congaloo!